morning and welcome. My name is Alison Ann, and I stand before you in my capacity as a civil funeral celebrant to lead today's ceremony and to celebrate the life of Lynn. We extend our thoughts to those who are unable to be physically present today. Lynn's daughter, Rebecca, her husband, John, and granddaughter, Alicia, who are watching this service in Australia. I would like to start today's service by reading a poem on behalf of Rachel. There are no words to express how much I'm missing you. You are more than just a mum to me. You are my best friend too. It broke my heart to lose you, knowing you were gone. But now you're my guardian angel for me to call upon. So I know that when I need you, you will always be by my side forever, watching over me. Thank you, Dave. Would you like to join me?
Thank you, Alison. My Lynn, my best friend. I tell you we were shocked when told that Lynn had motor neurone disease. But what I can say is how much support we've had from the Heart of Kent and the MND Association. It's an honour to have with us today Annette. She's the chair of the MND Association for Mid Kent. Annette Scott, thank you for joining us today and the help you've gave us over the last 10 months. Everyone gave us 100%. Include their families. So thank you all. It would mean the world to me to know that her family surrounds her today. I only wish I'd both my daughters would by me by my side. I've had a little message this morning from Rebecca, and she's asked for me to blow a kiss for a mum one more time. Today is my birthday, and I thought it was fitting that we should be together to share a very special day. I'm going to leave things to the cheating for Caitlin and for Alison. My personal thoughts are mine and mine alone. How do I put into words 51 years together? My Lynn is the perfect wife and mother. Annette, a sister and a daughter. Mum, you should be very proud of your eldest daughter. Lynn loved the film Mamma Mia, and the following song was chosen by Rachel for you too, Alicia. So.
I had a dream, there was some to see. If you see the wonder of a fairy tale, you can take the future, even if you fail. I believe in angels, something good in everything I see. I believe in angels, when I know the time is right for me. I'll cross the stream. I have a dream.
I started talking about the MND Association. And should you want to donate, the details are on the back of the order of service. Thank you all for coming today on this very special day for Lynn. The next April is Lynn's birthday, when I hope we can all get together to celebrate Lynn's life. And those that do not know, a celebrant is a personal friend of Rebecca and John. Alison has gone out of her way to make this a very special day for us all. So thank you, Alison.
Thank you, Dave. Today, I could sketch a beautiful picture of Lynn and ask that you all fill in the colours with your own memories to complete the portrait, but no one can tell the story of Lynn's life better than those who loved her the most. 3 days ago, Rebecca sent through a eulogy for Lynn that was so heartfelt and so eloquently written. I have weaved Rebecca's words between those of Lynn's sisters, Dave, and the memories that both Rebecca and Rachel have shared with me, if only we had an hour to do so. Lynn Ann Coward was born on Friday the 7th of April 1950, the first child born to Ronald and Eileen Coward. The family lived at the Flower House estate in Downham. As a family, they would often go to Nan Sullivan's for parties. Lynn loved her Nan Sullivan. At the age of 5, Lynn's sister Brenda was born, followed by Michael in 1956 and Teresa 6 years later in 1962. Setting up a home at Pendragon Road, the family never owned a car, but Ronald would hire one to take his family on holidays. To quote Lynn, "We loved that time. It was so exciting." Lynn remembers her father Ronald as a hard-working, lovely man. In 1966, Ronald suffered a heart attack, leaving Eileen at the age of 38 to raise 4 children on her own. Lynn was only 16 at the time. Eileen worked tirelessly to provide for her 4 children. As the eldest child, Lynn took on a more nurturing role with her siblings. The Coward family always stuck together. That never changed over the years. Teresa and Brenda insist that Lynn was the glue that held their family together. Teresa recalls fun times going shopping and seeing shows with Lynn. Brenda and Lynn loved shopping also, often leaving first thing in the morning and returning late in the afternoon. Brenda told me she was such a beautiful person inside and out. Over the years, Rebecca asked her mother what she wanted to be when she grew up. Lynn's answer was always the same. "I only ever wanted to be a mum." Rebecca explains, "Just a child herself, really, my mum began her dream job at the tender age of 18. This soft, unassuming, often a pushover kind of lady was also exceptionally willful when she needed to be. It wasn't easy to be a young mum, but it was her calling, and she certainly wasn't going to let anyone take it away from her." On December 15th, 1969, Lynn met a young man at her friend Shirley Porter's house. Dave Smart was in the Parachute Regiment in the Army at the time. Dave and Lynn's first date was at a pub in Crystal Palace. The couple formed a connection that endured throughout his tours in Northern Ireland. Of course, there were no such things as mobile telephones, but their courtship revolved around the writing and receiving of letters. When asked to describe Linda when he met her, Dave recalled her lovely, natural auburn hair, smiled and said, "She was lovely." Eileen was rather cautious of this enthusiastic army lad. She was fiercely protective of her daughter and refused to let him in the house. It didn't take long, however, for Dave to prove to Eileen that his love for her daughter was steadfast. He fully embraced everything about Lynn. Lynn was drawn to Dave's strength, his loyalty. He was always there for her. He was great in a crisis. Dave left the army in 1972, returned home to Lynn, and trained to be a licensed London taxi driver. The couple were married at Lewisham Registry Office on the 17th of September, 1973. Whilst on a waiting list for a place in Kidbrook, they lived with Eileen for a year until they moved into their first home in Wordsworth Road in Welling. The couple were blessed to raise two daughters, Rachel and Rebecca. Rebecca happily recalls, "We were spoiled. People often scorn spoiled children, but to my mum, children were to be spoiled. Spoiled with love, support, kind words, care, and hugs. Also with chocolate and ice cream for breakfast. She simply had the biggest heart and lived to make us happy. Christmas was a time of special memories. New 90s, decorations galore, a sofa each full of presents, and Mum up early before the rest of us preparing the dinner. One of Rebecca's earliest memories was discovering that it wasn't in fact Santa downstairs making noise on Christmas morning, it was my mother with a hand up the turkey's bottom. Christmas lists as long as your arm. Open the catalogues and go to town. If Mum could pay it off all year, you could pretty much have it. Just don't tell Dad. Was there anything a woman wouldn't do to make us happy? Growing up, our parents demonstrated and instilled many lessons. Dad taught us values such as persistence, resilience, and integrity. Mum taught us acceptance, forgiveness, and kindness. Mum never had a bad word to say about anyone and would rarely take sides. Instead, she would look to see a different perspective and always try to see both sides of the story. She was the peacekeeper, our best friend, our confidant. Family was Lynn's world. Rebecca tells me, when Rachel and I had babies of our own, Mum relived her glory days through her grandchildren. Rachel fondly remembers Mum giving Daniel his first bath and then giving her constant support while she navigated her way into the new world of motherhood. Later, as Rachel struggled with her health, Mum stood steadfastly by her side. There were dark times for Rachel, but Mum was a constant source of support and comfort. Whether she sat aside quietly by her bedside, passed the time with idle chit-chat, or listened without casting judgment or opinion, Mum was the best friend to Rachel and her lifeline. Lynn arranged most of Rachel's wedding to Ian in 1995. She went with Rachel to get her dress, she organized the catering, and the cake too. Rachel tells me she was always there. Of course, Rachel and Lynn also shared an interest in life's more serious issues. EastEnders, Coronation Street, gossip magazines, home interior shows, and a fun afternoon was flicking through the next directory. As Lynn's dream job was to be a mum, Rebecca's was to be a dancer. My parents, a taxi driver and washer-upper, supported my interest in the strange world of ballet. They never questioned my choices. Mum washed a lot of dishes to be able to give me the kind of opportunities that went beyond her wildest dreams. It broke her heart and mine when I left for boarding school, but she supported it because it was what I wanted. I still have on my desk a plaque she once bought me. The future belongs to those who believe in the beauty of their dreams. I will be forever grateful that she believed in mine. Naturally, Lynn was disappointed when Rebecca and John made the brave decision to move to Australia in 2008. But within months of leaving, Lynn and Dave booked their first of many holidays down under. Rebecca and Rachel remember their mother's gentleness, thoughtfulness, and her kindness. Lynn's family was her world. Her husband, her beautiful daughters, and none were more precious to Lynn than her grandchildren, Daniel and Alicia. Lynn's sisters describe Dave and Lynn as a loving couple, married for 47 years, together for 51. Dave smiles and confesses to me she put up with a lot. Lynn tells me that Dave would often be a wind-up and Lynn would put him in his place, but they were inseparable. Dave describes Lynn as caring, loving, and honest. Rebecca describes her mother as a house elf. She was never happier than when she was cleaning the bathroom or the kitchen and everything else in between. One of her greatest concerns was how Dad would keep the house when she was gone. Brain tells me, if he slacks with the cleaning, I'm sure Lynn will be in his ear telling him to keep it up. Reading a book, going for a walk, visiting Leeds Castle, the very mention of Alicia or Daniel, all of these things brought Lynn happiness. Rebecca acknowledges that there was one place in which Lynn struggled to find that same light, and that was in herself. A diffident lady, Mum failed to see all the things that you all celebrate in her today. Coward by name, coward by nature, she would say to Rebecca. If only Lynn could have seen herself as Rachel and Rebecca saw her. Capable, strong, brave, and beautiful. Dave and Lynn got through the hardest year of their lives, side by side, facing cancer head on. Following her diagnosis of MND, it was heartbreaking for the family to watch Lynn's health decline. Bren remarked that Dave was devoted in the exceptional care, love, and support that he gave Lynn. He always made her feel safe. Lynn was the love of his life, and he would have done anything for her. A final thought from Rebecca. I see now exactly why being a mum is your calling. It is perhaps the most important role in the world. You provided the emotional backbone to our family. You did your best to keep your loved ones safe and happy. You healed all wounds. You made great sacrifices to give your children all that you could. You loved us both unconditionally. You supported our dreams, gently wiped our tears, and made the world a better place. Our world was all the better for having you as our mum. And we thank you, honour you, and miss you today and always. You each have your own personal memories of Lynn. The last time you held her hand, that last FaceTime call, the last time you kissed her goodnight. Eileen describes her daughter as her firstborn, helpful, loving. Bren describes her as caring, beautiful, kind, and gentle. To Teresa, she is a second mother, a best friend. No one will replace her. Her brother Nick puts it quite simply, love you girl. To Rachel, her mother is loving, caring, brave, and kind. She was my best friend. Rebecca describes her mother as selfless, kind, and gentle. To Dave, she was the perfect wife. In true Lynn fashion, she refused the medication on offer even in her final weeks. She was fully alert and she intended to stay that way. She knew her own mind and she was going to say goodbye on her terms. Linda Ann Smart died peacefully in her sleep at home with the love of her life by her side on Monday the 12th of October 2020. If Lynn left this earth knowing one thing, it's that she was loved by you all. each human life is unique. Look through your whole world and there is no one like Lynn. Although no longer a visible part of your lives, Lynn will always remain a part of your family or of your circle of friends through the influence she has had on you and the special part she has played in each of your lives. Before bidding Lynn goodbye, there will be a few moments' silence for each of you to recall your favourite memories of her, or to say a quiet prayer should you wish to do so. With love and appreciation, we now release the body of Linda Ann Smart to its end with nature. Be thankful for her life, for the love she gave, for her contribution to your world. Nothing good about Lynn's life will be lost. All that was important to her will be respected by those who remain, and all that was great about her will continue to burn brightly within each of you. With love, leave her in peace. With respect, bid her farewell.
Still our guide, and though we cannot see you, you are always at hand.
start. Our family chain is broken, and nothing seems the same. But as God calls us one by one, the chain will then come. Thank you, Teresa. The needs of those who grieve can differ from moment to moment, day to day, and week to week. Sometimes the need to be alone and quiet conflicts with the need to talk at length. The need to cry can be at odds with pulling yourself together or getting on with life. In the coming weeks and months, each of you will try to make some sense of your future without Lynn. Trust that you are each connected by the uniqueness of today's service and by your love of Lynn. The way in which you will all grieve will be as unique as the relationship you have with her. So, be gentle with each other. Be there to support one another, to give your time, kindness and understanding to each other, now and in the days, weeks and months ahead.
Summer and walks down.